presiding elder Williams. To all of you, my father's children, it's just good to be here. Amen. I know it's kind of warm, but anybody glad to be in the house of the Lord? Hallelujah. When you consider the alternative, just think about it. This is hot as it's going to get for you because you know Jesus. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. We just thank God for the opportunity once more and again to enter into the house of prayer. And for what a great occasion to celebrate 100 years in existence. Amen. 100 years serving the Lord. 100 years blessing this community. 100 years. That's a blessing. I like to tell people when they start contemplating, Pastor, why they start contemplating the years the church has been in service, I like to tell them I'm not the founding pastor. I don't know about you. I like to make that clear. Yeah, not the founding pastor. Sister, well, I don't believe you're the founding pastor. If you are, you look great for 100 years. God bless you. Amen. God bless you. Amen. We are so glad. It's good to have joy, isn't it? Bible says that in the Lord we find our joy. The joy of the Lord is our strength. I wouldn't be a Christian if I couldn't have some joy. I tell you that it's good to have joy in the Lord. We get happy about all kinds of other things. Don't get quiet now. When it comes to talking about Jesus, you shout for the 49ers, you shout for the Raiders, you shout for the Sacramento Kings. It takes some real faith to shout for the King. If you're going to shout for all of them, you may as well shout for Jesus. Hallelujah. Yeah, we thank God. We thank God for the Lord Jesus Christ. I won't be before you long because I want to make way for the preacher. I want to be preached to myself. Amen. Amen. This is a Bible lesson, and I'm coming from your theme, the joy of faithfulness, remembering the past, rejoicing in the present, and investing in the future. I think that is a great theme. I think that's a great theme. Coming from Hebrews, the 13th chapter, and the concentration we will be looking at is verses 7 through 9. But before we get there, let me just say, when we take a brief overview of Hebrews to get to this 13th chapter, I believe that we find all of these things encompassed. Remembering the past, rejoicing in the present, and investing in the future. I believe if we look over the book of Hebrews, even though we don't know who the author was, we know that the author behind the author was the Holy Ghost. Is that right?
Yeah.
Amen. And as we look at chapter 1, it reveals to us the theme of the entire book of Hebrews by establishing the supremacy of Christ. As we look over chapter 2, it warns us not to stop obeying the word of God. When we look over chapter 3, it teaches us that Jesus is proclaimed as being greater than Moses. And as we move to chapter 4, amen, amen. As we move to chapter 4, God promises a rest for his people. Anybody want rest? Amen, somebody. In chapter 5, Christ is established as our high priest. And in chapter 6, believers are encouraged to strive for spiritual maturity. Don't just stay on milk, but you ought to eat some meat every once in a while. On chapter 7, the priesthood of Christ is compared to that of Melchizedek. And on chapter 8, it reveals how much better the new covenant is than the old. In chapter 9, it compares our earthly sanctuary to the heavenly sanctuary and shows us how every practice points to Christ. In chapter 10, it points to the supremacy of Christ as our sacrifice over that of the blood of animals such as lambs. In chapter 11, it contains the hall of fame of biblical heroes and it is demonstrating their faith. In chapter 12, it compares the Christian walk to a race to be won. And in chapter 13, it tells us how to win the race. And somebody ought to say thank you, Lord. God didn't set us on a path of a race into spiritual maturity and to reach that overcomer status and make our way into glory without telling us first how we ought to get there. And in the text here, it begins by telling us that it all starts with love. It all starts with loving God and loving one another. And he gives us in this chapter 13 some parting words that will take us to a place that if we adhere to the word of God, we're going to reach the finish line. And it all starts with our love for Jesus Christ. Isn't that right? Loving Christ makes all the difference. It makes the difference now, and it'll make the difference in eternity. The text says in chapter 13, verse 7 through 9, remember them which have the rule over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation. Jesus Christ the same yesterday and today and forever, but not carried about, verse 9, with diverse and strange doctrines. I want to look at this text, and there's just a few points I want to highlight, and then I will get out of the way and take my seat. The very first thing it tells us is to remember those who have rule over us. We live in a time where we don't want to take any instruction from anybody. Everybody wants to be the boss, and too many chiefs and not enough Indians. In your workplace, you ever notice all the bosses sitting up in the office and you down there doing the work? You taking credit, they taking credit for the work you do. That we live in an age where there's too many chiefs and not enough Indians, too many bosses and not enough laborers. And the word of God, if we're not careful, we would start to disrespect or dishonor those who have authority over us. But God's word reminds us that we ought to hold those that have rule over us, that we ought to remember them, we ought to reverence them, we ought to hold them up in esteem, especially those, as he qualifies it, who have spoken unto us the word of God. Yeah. The word of God, he didn't say you get up here and you start talking anything you want to talk and you're supposed to honor that man or woman of God. He didn't say that. The scripture said that we ought to remember those who have spoken to you the word of God. Let me just say first before I go on that the preacher gets up to serve God first and then to serve you. If they just wanted to hear the word, they could preach themselves happy. They could stay home and not make the trip. They stay in the shower. I do my best preaching in the shower. I just want you to know it sure sounds good in the acoustics. And I get my little hollers on, and it sounds real good in the shower. But I get dressed anyway, and I make my trip to Shiloh Baptist Church every Sunday so I can bring them the word of God, because it's not just for me, it's for you. And the Bible says you ought to remember those who have spoken the word of God to you. Yeah. Romans 10 and 14 says, how then shall they call unto him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of who they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? I came by to let you know you ought to remember those that have brought you the word of God. 2 Timothy 4 and 2 said, preach the word, be instant in season and out of season. Reprove and rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. I came by to let you know today, the Bible said, don't take preachers said, the Bible said, you ought to remember those that have preached the word of God to you. And not only remember them, not only hold them in esteem, but they ought to walk what they talk. Yeah. Whose faith a follower, a faith you ought to follow. When you see your pastor living a life full of faith, then you ought to follow that example. Follow him as they follow Christ. I was at a deacon candidate meeting last night, And one of the candidates asked me, was there a uniform, deacons? They wanted to know if there was a uniform for being a deacon. I thought it was a good question. We began to talk about the first Sunday in our faith. We wear a uniform, our deacon board, on first Sundays, similar to what y'all have on today, with the black suit, the white shirt, and the red tie. And on funerals, they shift up on the tie and wear a black tie. But on the other Sundays, they are left to their own discretion. But I didn't want to leave the new deacon candidates that loose, is that right? So I let them know. Some of them are in the choir stand right now. I told them, I tell you what, don't get up here on Sunday morning wearing just any old thing. Don't act like you crazy. I tell you what you do. I get in the pulpit every Sunday morning and you see what I wear. So you just follow the example of your pastor. When your pastor starts dressing crazy, you can start dressing crazy. Until you see me dress crazy, don't you come in here dressing crazy. You follow the example of your pastor. I'm just trying to say, you got an example right here in the form of Pastor White. You ought to follow the leadership that God has placed in front of you as they show their faith and point their way to Jesus Christ. The text says, considering the end of their conversation. Yeah, that conversation, that's more than just what they say. That word conversation denotes a manner of life, a conduct or behavior. That means they don't just walk it, but they talk it. And they don't just talk it, but they walk it. If you watch the behavior of your preachers in front of you, and it should be a behavior, the Bible says, that you would want to emulate. It should be a behavior that gives you an idea of what conduct of a mature Christian should look like. It says, consider the end of their conversation. We listen to a lot of things right now, don't we? We get things like, we got TVs telling us all kinds of crazy things. We got our newspaper telling us all kinds of crazy things. We go to the grocery store, you may hear all kinds of crazy things. Go to the bank, and while you in line, somebody turn around and tell you some crazy stuff. We get messed everywhere we go sometimes. And I don't know about you, but sometimes I get sick and tired of hearing mess. I need a clear word from the Lord. I need a word I can stand on, a word I can trust, a word that tells me what right is and what wrong is, a word that doesn't matter what the polls say, it doesn't matter what you're thinking. It doesn't matter what they thought. Now, I don't want to know what you thought, because just because that's what you thought doesn't mean that's what you're thinking, because that's what you think doesn't mean that's what you think. I need a word that I can hold on to. One that I can go to bed and say I did the right thing. One that I can wake up and say I did the right thing. I know it's right because the word of God said it's right. You ought to hear the conversation of the way of life, the conduct, the behavior as your preachers live the word of God before you. You ought to hold their conversation. You ought to consider it before you listen to that news. We believe the news. Isn't that right? Yeah. Somebody, the news people lied this week. Did they tell y'all it was going to rain yesterday and the day before? Did y'all get any rain? I brought my jacket the other night because they told me if they rain. I had no goddamn rain. I haven't washed my car. My car dirty, preacher, because they told me it was going to rain. And it ain't rained not now bit. Amen. Can I say it like that? Right here in Sacramento. It ain't rained not now bit on my window. I could have washed my car on Saturday and been straight instead of riding around with a dirty car. We listen to them, but we don't want to listen to the word of God. Yeah, listen to everybody else, but what we listen to the word of God. The word of God is what will save you. The word of God is what will keep you. The word of God is what will direct you. We hear everybody else, we ought to listen to the word of God. The text says, I'm about done now. I'm about done. The text says here, be not carried about with diverse and strange doctrines. We got a group of preachers this generation. I don't mean no harm. They could be young and they could be old, but it seems like there's some mess coming out over the pulpit these days. Seems like every once in a while you go to church and you go to hear a word from God. You hear worthy. There's a mess coming across the pulpit. And if you're not careful, you might get twisted. If you're not careful, you might let them shake your faith. That's why you need to know the word for yourself. You need to be a Berean and have this in your spirit. So when they say something that's not contrary to the word of God, you know it because you got the right standard in this here word of God. But you got to be careful. There's some, everybody that say they're a Christian don't necessarily mean they're a Christian. Everybody say they're a preacher don't necessarily mean they're a preacher. They may walk like a preacher. They may talk like a preacher. They may holler like a preacher. But I came by to let you know today that everybody that shouts hallelujah don't know the same God you know. But you ought to watch out for yourself that you can be his sound doctrine. I'm going to have to sit down and let the preacher have his way. Verse 8.